the Orthodox Theological Society is meeting with us at this meeting. And they have a Florovsky lecture, which is their main lecture, and we have a keynote lecture, which is our main lecture. So we decided that we would join them together. And so I'm going to introduce the president of the Orthodox Theological Society, who will introduce our keynote and Florovsky lecturer. Dr. Teva Regul received her MDiv from Holy Cross Greek Orthodox Seminary, and then PhD from Boston College, focusing her work on liturgical theology and history. She's done a great deal of youth work over the years. She's done women's initiatives, and she's currently on the board of St. Phoebe Center for the Deaconess. She's now entering her fourth year as president of Orthodox Theological Society of America, OTSA. She says this will be her last, but none of us, we're all hoping that's not the case. Please, let's welcome Teva to come up and talk.
Thank you. Thank you to Gail. As she mentioned, I am the current president of the Orthodox Theological Society in America, or OTSA. The Orthodox Theological Society was organized in 1966 and is now an affiliated professional association of the Assembly of Bishops of the United States of America. And for those of you who'd like to learn more about OTSA, I invite you to attend our roundtable session where we will discuss our mission and work. Session 86, tomorrow night from 5:30 to 7 at the Park Hotel. As part of the outreach of the Society, we offer a public lecture each year in conjunction with our annual meeting in honor of the renowned Orthodox theologian, George Frolovsky, and we are pleased to help sponsor the keynote address this evening as part of that series. And I would now like to introduce our speaker. His Eminence Metropolitan Ambrosios, Metropolitan of Korea and Exarch of Japan, is a bishop of the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople. He is also a professor at the Department of Greek Studies and Hankuk University of Foreign Studies in South Korea. Born on the island of Aegina in Greece in 1960, His Eminence later graduated from the School of Theology of the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens. He holds master's degrees from Hellenic College, Holy Cross, and Princeton University, and a PhD from the School of Theology and the University of Athens. In 1985, he was ordained deacon, and in 1991, a priest. His Eminence left for Korea literally the day after he defended his dissertation in 1998, and has been wholeheartedly committed to the Orthodox faithful of Korea ever since. Upon his arrival in Korea, he served as the Dean of St. Nicholas Orthodox Cathedral in Seoul. His Eminence was elected and enthroned as Metropolitan of Korea in 2006 and elected Metropolitan of Korea and Exarch of Japan in 2008. Metropolitan Ambrosios has worked tirelessly to become fluent in Korean and serve the Korean Orthodox flock of approximately 8,000 faithful, and to increase the Orthodox witness on the Korean peninsula. He has done this by supporting native Korean clergy and cultivating priestly vocations, meeting the pastoral needs of Orthodox Christians from all ethnic and cultural backgrounds who live in Korea, establishing a high-quality publication house to translate and print Orthodox books in Korean, expanding youth ministries and summer-winter camping programs, hosting frequent conferences on Orthodox theology, spirituality, and art, deepening ties with Korean universities, participating extensively in ecumenical and interfaith dialogues, and through many other efforts. His Eminence was the first non-native Korean to be elected by his peers as president of the National Council of Churches of Korea, and is deeply respected and loved by his fellow religious leaders, university colleagues, students, and the Orthodox faithful in his care. He has written and spoken extensively on Orthodox mission and witness, drawing from the patristic tradition and his direct experience of nearly 25 years. We warmly welcome His Eminence Metropolitan Ambrosios to offer the keynote address of IOTA and OTSA's Florovsky address.
Thank you. Your Eminence, Metropolitan Ignatius of Dimitrias and Almiros, your Eminences, Reverend Fathers and Deacons, Εξοχοτάκητη κυρία Υπουργέ, dear professors, beloved sisters and brothers in Christ. First of all, I have an honor and a special privilege to convey to you the paternal blessings and love of His All Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, who is in you a blessed new year and a successful conference. On January 24, 2022, I was honored with an invitation to be the keynote speaker during this second conference of the International Orthodox Theological Association, centering on the topic of Orthodox mission. I am very grateful to the conference organizers and to the Most Reverend Metropolitan Ignatius of Dimitrias and Almiros for their kind invitation and generous hospitality. I began preparing my speech with caution and awe. I was mindful both of the huge responsibility of this special opportunity, and of the fact that the keynote speaker in 2019 in Iasi, Romania, was the internationally renowned Orthodox theologian, Metropolitan Callistos Ware of Dioclea, of blessed memory. May we continue to have his prayers, and may his memory be eternal. Exactly 1 month after I received this invitation to speak, however, things change radically in terms of Orthodox mission and witness to the world. As you all know, on February 24, 2022, the terrible war in Ukraine escalated on a massive scale. I immediately knew that I had to change the subject and nature of my speech, because I believe it is unacceptable for a meeting of Orthodox theologians to simply converse about theories at the time when worldwide Orthodoxy is being presented and charged externally by global public opinion based on concrete facts, based on bombs and body counts, and at a time when worldwide Orthodoxy is also being tested internally by the shocking and convicting reality of one predominantly Orthodox country invading and violating, attacking another Orthodox country. In good conscience, what inspiring words can we possibly speak about Orthodox witness to the nations within this current historical reality? Furthermore, it is an unspeakable travesty not only that this war is Orthodoxy's current witness to the world, but that most Orthodox leaders worldwide have failed to condemn this diabolical war unequivocally. We cannot even say, well, this is a war driven by politicians, our churches are against it, because so few of our church leaders have actually taken a public anti-war stance. Having said this, I do want to commend IOTA for publishing a clear and immediate anti-war statement on your website. Since this is a gathering of theologians focusing on the theme of Orthodox witness in the midst of the current war, its keynote speech should examine the missiological heresy which lies at the root of the world, the great heresy of ethnophileticism. According to His Eminence Metropolitan John Zizoulias of Pergamon, ethnophileticism is nothing less than, quote, the greatest danger to the unity of the Orthodox Church, unquote. It is important to emphasize right from the start that whoever claims to work for the Church and at the same time serves ethnophileticism betrays in practice the very nature of the Church. Since much has already been written about ethnophileticism history within Orthodoxy, and because I'm quite sure the members of IOTA are well informed about ethnophileticism as a heresy within our tradition, I will instead analyze in a more personal way the effects of ethnophileticism upon our efforts to spread Orthodox witness to the nations. My analysis is based on my experiences for several decades in the Far East, especially in Korea, where I have been serving since 1998. After this, I will conclude with a few suggestions for how we can move beyond ethnophileticism and toward an authentic Orthodox witness. I am taking this more personal and less academic approach because when I discuss the matter with Orthodox theologians and church leaders, it seems that most of them have no grasp on the enormous problems ethnophileticism causes to our theology, or the terrible consequences of the rampant ethnophileticism upon Orthodox missions. Perhaps this is because they have not experienced the problems directly or suffer these heresies' consequences on a personal level. Part one. The negative effects of ethnophileticism in many areas of the church life is a very sad reality. However, the most serious negative impact is in the area of evangelizing the nations. The promising revival of Orthodox witness in the 20th century is being endangered by the serious problems that arose after the fall of communism regimes in so-called Orthodox countries, some of which have sought to expand into other ecclesiastical jurisdictions. In other words, after the collapse of communism in Eastern Europe, instead of pursuing an approach to Orthodox missions for the 21st century that was based on proper Orthodox ecclesiology and canon law, instead, competitive politics prevail based on anthro-racial criteria. We are all aware of the scandal suffered by Orthodox believers in different jurisdictions from the uncanonical situation prevailing in the Orthodox diaspora. However, many of us may not see the enormous scandal caused by this canonical anomaly to non-Orthodox, non-Christians, and non-religious people. The heresy of ethnophileticism is a stumbling block to the weak and threatens to destroy the genuine criteria for spreading Orthodox witness. We Orthodox resisted colonialism with contaminated the preaching of Christ with violence and scandalized countless souls who might otherwise have embraced the faith. Yet, unfortunately, we Orthodox gave in to ethnophiletism, a flesh-eating disease that eats away at the church, the body of Christ, and causes many problems to those inside and outside, as Saint John Chrysostom would say. In other words, ethnophiletism becomes a reason for the Orthodox to be sad, the heterodox to be scandalized, and the atheist to rejoice. Thus, the question arises, how is possible to approach non-Orthodox, non-Christians, and non-religious people when in the same city and sometimes in the same neighborhood there are Orthodox churches belonging to different jurisdictions, each of which invites the same people into their community by saying, come to us, don't go there. When some clerics infiltrate foreign jurisdictions, they are acting like the alien bishops, allotrioepiscopi, the troublemakers about whom the Apostle Peter tells us. Such clergy even dare to appear as conquerors by using treacherous and illegal means, which are condemned even by the common criminal law. They occupy holy churches and remove native clergy from the local canonical church using immoral bait. Consider the recent uncanonical incursion of the Moscow Patriarchate into Africa, a fact that has caused immeasurable distress to the Patriarch and the faithful of the ancient and historic Patriarchate of Alexandria and all Africa. We must seriously ask ourselves, how shall we do missionary work to outsiders if we are fighting among ourselves? The heresy of ethnophiletism brought the Church of Christ to this sad, very sad state. What I am describing here with great, great pain of soul, believe me, please, it is simply the result of what I have read. It is not simply the result of what I have read or heard from others. It is my direct experience of recent years in Korea. Let me say up front that our ministry in Korea, with the grace of God, is always done with an ecumenical and never an ethnic spirit. For example, we never use the word Greek in referring to the Orthodox Church in Korea. We are simply the Orthodox Metropolis of Korea. We strive here to follow faithfully the Holy Great Church of Christ, which, in the words of His Holiness the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, quote, never serve nationalism, which is an alienation from the consciousness of the Church's universality and the abolition of the principle of synodality in it. Right here, I will skip the historical fact of how the Orthodox Korean Church was established for reasons of time. Soon after the dissolution of the Soviet Union in 1991, the claims of the Moscow Patriarchate began in Korea under the constant pretext that it was necessary to establish a Russian jurisdiction there in order to cover the needs of the newly arrived Russian immigrants in the Korean Peninsula. When the first wave of Russians and other Slavic speakers arrived in Korea in 1992, Metropolitan Soterios of Pisidia, the former Metropolitan of Korea, now of blessed memory, took over their liturgical and pastoral care with a genuine ecclesiastical attitude. First of all, he oversaw the construction of the Holy Church of Saint Maximus in Seoul, the foundation stone of which was laid by His Holiness the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew during his first official visit in 1995. Also, Metropolitan Soterios arranged through the Ecumenical Patriarchate for a Russian priest to come from the Moscow Patriarchate to take over the pastoral care of the Slavonic people and to serve under his homophorion, that is, under the local bishop in Korea. Thus, Koreans and Slavic speakers, as well as believers of other nationalities of the Orthodox diaspora in Korea, coexisted in complete harmony, under the paternal care of a single bishop on the Korean peninsula. Unfortunately, this reality lasted only until Christmas 2018, when, despite our numerous appeals to the ecclesiastical and diplomatic agents of Russia, the Moscow Patriarchate decided to destroy the normal ecclesiastical order in Korea. The great harm done by our Moscow Patriarchate brothers lies in the fact that the Orthodox Church of Korea functioned previously as a model local Orthodox Church. That is, it was a unique case of the existence of a single bishop in the same place for all the Orthodox, regardless of race, language, ethnic, and cultural identity. The Russian ethnophiletic argument was and still is that they have the obligation to care for their flock. To our argument that the Russian immigrants in Korea already have a pastor along with everything else they need for their liturgical and pastoral needs, the Moscow Patriarchate replies, yes, but they need their mother church. And when they realize that their argument was in violation of Orthodoxy's canonical tradition, their response was, anyway, there is a place for missionary activity for everyone in Korea. We reminded the Moscow Patriarchate that the heterodox use exactly the same argument with a light conscience, since they are not bound by any ecclesiology. That's why they establish new churches wherever they want and do whatever they wish. Also here, omit a small part. This is not the place for a detailed account of what is happening today in Korea. We will say only that the faithful in Korea have been scandalized profoundly by the abnormal behavior of some of the representatives of the newly established parties under the Moscow Patriarchate, which they maintain in a rented hall. How many tears we have seen Russian and Belarusian adults and children cry because they have been divided and their friendships have been destroyed. Some representatives of the Moscow Patriarchate have also made a painful impression on our Korean clergy, whom they dared to call in order to convince them to leave the Korean church under the Ecumenical Patriarchate, saying that we are schismatic and to come instead under the jurisdiction of Russia. As we mentioned above, even more serious is the problem of the creation of the new non-canonical jurisdiction, which has caused a scandal towards the non-Orthodox in Korea. During the joint meetings at the Commission of the Theological Dialogue and at the General Assemblies of the National Council of Churches in Korea, NCCK, in which we participate actively, we are often asked, what is it that we hear? What's going on with the Russians? Are there multiple Eastern Orthodox churches in Korea now? How are we supposed to answer? We limit ourselves to saying that we pray and hope that this very sad story ends soon. Part two, thoughts on overcoming the problem of ethnophiletism. Our motivation for arguing the issue is not, as you can understand, polemic or political. It is rather an issue that hurts us deeply, and the question is, how shall we move beyond this impasse? To what extent do we want to live in a way worthy to him who calls us to the new life, according to St. Paul? Our preoccupation with the problem of ethno-racism is in direct connection with our fidelity to the character of our Christian identity. In other words, do we want to follow politics prioritizing ethnicity and race, or follow the church prioritizing our united identity in Christ? This is where the essence of the whole matter is focused. Again, St. Paul's words are instructive. Quote, there is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus, unquote. Due to ethnophiletism, many actions of ecclesiastical officials are not ecclesiastical at all, but clearly political. Yet, these church actions are dressed so deceptively with an ecclesiastical cover, making it easy for some to proclaim, this is an ecclesiastical act. The misfortune is that these events and practices are baptized as ecclesiastical acts, and most people do not even suspect the infiltration of Caesaropapism into the church. Some of the church's clergy have fallen into the trap of promoting national instead of ecclesiastical interest, of worshiping worldly power and authority. Therefore, today, just as with the Bulgarian issue in the past, the worldly interest is being placed above the spiritual and religious. Numbers and population data have become a criterion of church decision making. For example, ceremonies are held with the participation of numerous prelates, and while at first sight it seems this is an ecclesiastical act, nevertheless, in the background, the mystery of the mysteries turns into a political act, which aims to demonstrate power and authority. In other words, from the percentage of participation of hierarchs of various jurisdictions, the functional event aims to draw conclusions about who has the upper hand in the matter of primacy. Such unacceptable mixtures of ecclesiastical and political actions causes confusion to many members of the church, because most of the time they do not have the knowledge of to distinguish the boundaries between the church and the world. As a result, we educate the faithful by our own actions to confuse these limits. Yet, how many of us really understand the danger this poses for our church and for our theology? His Holiness Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew writes, quote, "Ethnophiletism has led to the weakening of the conscience about the Eucharistic realization of the Church. In the name of nationalistic purposes, the priority of eschatological identity of the Church and Eucharistic ecclesiology as well have been sacrificed. The instrumentalization of the Eucharist and its transformation into a means of exercising ecclesiastical politics and pressures, as it is done today in the case of the Ukrainian autocephaly by the Church of Moscow, proves the continuing presence of ethnic criteria in the ecclesiastical life of Orthodoxy, as well as the need to resist such practices and the need to return to the beginning of the Eucharistic formation and synodical function of the Orthodox Church," unquote. How can the Church deal in practice with this serious problem? Ethnophiletists have means at their disposal that anti-ethnophiletists lack. And the problem is that the secular means they use are more understandable in today's society because they match the mentality and habits of modern people. However, this reality is the epitome of the negative spirit of secularization. Few people understand or experience a genuine ecclesiastical attitude. Thus, not until most of the faithful wake up and understand that such secular thinking is foreign to the church proper, to the church's proper ethos, a false tradition will have been formed, which will not be easily restored. Due to the lack of authentic ecclesiastical practice, when we discuss the problem of ethnophiletism in the Orthodox diaspora, the usual reaction is that different jurisdictions existing in the same place is natural and self-evident, or at the very least, a necessary evil. In my humble opinion, this reaction has an absolutely clear reason. We, Orthodox believers around the world, are not actually the body of Christ. We feel that we are not brothers in Christ, but strangers. As much as repeating the theory that we are connected by our shared orthodoxy, in practice, our national identity has priority, and our Orthodox faith comes second. First, we are Russians, Serbs, Bulgarians, Greeks, Romanians, Arabs, etc. And second comes our Orthodox identity. Thus, there is no deep desire to address ethnophiletism in diaspora, since it would require a spiritual revolution within our identities. It's absolutely necessary for us to understand that the nation, which is a worldly reality that will be abolished at the last days, eschata, should not for any reason be converted into an ecclesiastical criterion that destroys the unity of the church. And since national criteria often underlie decision making at a personal, local, or pan-Orthodox level, how can one check each time whether his or her criteria are ecclesiastical or ethnocentric? A sure proof of ethno-racial mentality, which places the ethnic identity of a believer above his ecclesiastical identity, is when, for example, they feel more familiar with an atheist or non-Christian fellow countryman than with an Orthodox believer of a different nationality. At this point, we consider it very useful to quote the words of Saint Sophrony of Essex, since this great theologian of our church clarifies the matter beautifully. He writes, quote, "I do not know a Greek Christ, a Russian Christ, an English Christ, an Arab Christ. Christ for me is everything, a supra cosmic being." When we demote the person of Christ, when we bring him down to the level of nationalities, we automatically lose everything and fall into darkness. Then the way is open for hatred between nations, for enmity between social groups. Unquote. The word of Saint Sophrony is particularly important nowadays when certain clerics make statements about the Philhellenic God, the Philo-Russian God, etc. How many wars between Orthodox countries have taken place for reasons of ethnophiletism? And how many civil conflicts were not caused by the decision of the citizens of the country into pro-Russian, pro-Hellenic, pro-Serbs, etc.? Today's problem, just as it used to be with newspapers, has entered the electronic world and is becoming a war between pro-Russian or anti-Russian homepages, etc. Instead of standing next to each other as brothers and sisters, our ethnophiletism separates us into opposing groups, ready for war. This is a huge problem. Our ethnophiletism makes us heretics because we did not place Christ and his church above everything. Christ is not everything in our life. What St. Cyril of Jerusalem calls the body and fellowship of Christ is for us inferior to our national or ethnic DNA. The language of love is of lower value than our national language and our cultural heritage. Can we completely believe our own words when we claim that the variety of national traditions confirms the unity of Orthodoxy in the community of faith and the bond of love? Our ethnophiletism is why we are frightened by the mere thought of the multi-ethnic congregation. We are afraid of losing our individuality, and we come to the easy conclusion that in order to have worship in our language and to preserve our ethnic and cultural traditions, we must necessarily have our own church, which, in the final analysis, looks more like an ethnic ghetto than a church in the foreign country where we live as an Orthodox diaspora. However, despite the massiveness of the problem, there is a solution. Glory be to God. Solutions have been recorded in the Book of Acts, as well as in the decisions of the Ecumenical and local synods. Therefore, we contemporary Christians, if we put aside our ethno-racial micropolitics, can find solutions about language issues, the issue of the nationality of our bishops and priests, as well as about everything else. If we truly want authentic Orthodoxy in the diaspora, we need to live outside the door of our church the political expediency of our place of origin. My own personal experience from the working for nearly three decades on the model of Orthodoxy in Korea, that is the multinational church community under one bishop, has firmly convinced me that not only is it possible to return to the normal canonical tradition and practice of the Orthodox Church, but also that our compliance with canon law will become a source of great blessing and infinite joy as a fruit of the Holy Spirit, since we will live in an atmosphere of Pentecost and communion in every worship gathering with our brothers and sisters. For the ethnophiletists who are willing to sacrifice the ecumenical character of the church on the altar of their nationalistic interest, perhaps the most important and vivid testimony of the proper application of the ecumenical spirit of Orthodoxy is the Athonite state. The Holy Mountain is an ecumenical state, with the ecumenical patriarch of Constantinople being its shepherd, in which many monks of different nationalities have lived harmoniously for centuries to this day. The criterion and point of reference for their coexistence is not their ethnic origin, but their Orthodox faith. Occasional attempts by external political and ecclesiastical factors of Slavic countries, mainly in the 19th century, and especially of Tsarist Russia, which were based on the organized plan, Pan-Slavism, for their descent into the Mediterranean, have been recorded in the tablets of history, as they try to alter the ecumenical identity of the Holy Mountain with ethnic criteria. Yet, they did not succeed. As much as the people of the Moscow Patriarchate repeat from time to time that the Holy Monastery of Panteleimon is their monastery, Russian monastery, it is known to all those who have a basic knowledge of ecclesiastical matters that the Holy Mountain belongs ecclesiastically to the Patriarchate of Constantinople and that the Ecumenical Patriarch is commemorated day and night as a spiritual father and bishop of all the monks, including those of Panteleimon. Having Mount Athos as a model, let us organize our metropolises and parishes in the Orthodox diaspora in the same way in order to have God's blessing and to bear fruitful witness to the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ in the world. My beloved, along with our fervent prayer for the abolition of heretical ethnophiletism within our Orthodox Church, let us clearly condemn it at the present International Conference of Orthodox Theologians, both theoretically and in practice. Let us take a public position on what is abnormal and uncanonical today in the jurisdiction of the Ecumenical Patriarchate, in the Far East, in Latin America, in Europe, and in Asia Minor, but also in the jurisdiction of the Patriarchate of Alexandria in Africa. Let us send a message of support to everyone who is suffering from the war in Ukraine, using theological, not political criteria, emphasizing that there is no greater sin than words, as Saint Sophronius says. Let us reject without any discussion the unorthodox theology of war, which for the last even 11 months is being reproduced by the supporters of the war in Ukraine. Let us emphasize that we are neither with NATO nor with Putin, but only with Jesus Christ. We are not part of any worldly coalition, but only members of the Church, the one body of Christ. Let us strive for a change of mentality and the acquisition of a genuine Orthodox ecclesiastical mind for the glory of God and the further expansion of His uncreated Church on earth. Let the prioritization of the national over the Orthodox Christian identity finally stop. And let all Orthodox theologians agree that ethnophiletism is diametrically opposed to the work of proclaiming the gospel because it is based exclusively on the blood of the ancestors, while the church is based on the blood of Christ. Thank you so very much for your kind patience.
Thank you, Your Eminence, for that really beautiful, beautiful lecture.